Hi everyone! So in every machine learning project we have to fulfill 5 steps, and today we're going to focus in this preprocess part. Actually, just one part of this preprocess, which is related to transformations, and we're going to cover different methods: mathematical transformation, calendar adjustments, and adjustments for inflation and population growth. So let's get started. So we're going to use massively these types of transformations, typically square root and logarithm. And basically the idea of these transformations is try to reduce heterogeneity, like in linear regression. So we want to have all the residuals normally distributed. Of course, we have to be careful with some transformations. So we cannot admit a negative argument here and a zero for the logarithm and the inverse. And remember that for money, I prefer to use the logarithm term instead of the natural logarithm. So let me show you an example. So imagine that you have this trend, which is electricity production in Australia, and you can see that the variance is increasing with time. So this, if I try to fit any regression model or any forecasting model, essentially I'm going to have larger residuals here or largely distributed residuals here than here. And this is called heterogeneity, okay? So essentially the transformation wants to produce residuals that are almost the same at the beginning and at the end. So let's try some of them. So you can see here that the square root is performing really well. So more or less the variance here and here are almost the same. The cube root is almost the same. The logarithm is not that good because you have some shrinking of the series here. And the negative reciprocal is absolutely rubbish because you can see that this is almost flat and the variance here is really large. If you remember, we have discussed previously the Box-Cox transformation, which is a summary of all these transformations. And essentially, in this formula, you contain all the transformations that I've shown before. So you can do this using the forecast library, using the Box-Cox lambda. This is estimates which is the best one, and this Box-Cox function applies this transformation. Or alternatively, you can use this in the library caret that we have used in the past, using the Box-Cox transformation. So in practice, in the square root and the logarithm are transformations most frequently used. So sometimes extracting the optimal value of lambda is distorting the data and is not very informative. So you know that I prefer the logarithm among the others. And if the logarithm is not working well, as we have seen in this example here, I would go to the square root, okay? So let me show you how it works. With lambda equals 1, you're not doing anything. If you increase lambda, you can see that the variance in the later times is increasing. If you go back to minus 1, you're shrinking too much the data. So probably the optimal is somewhere in the middle. Let's try the logarithm. Okay, not bad, but you still have some small value. And around 0.3, you have a kind of optimal value because the variance is almost the same everywhere. Of course, these transformations are purely mathematical, and they are not taking into account that sometimes these time series are related to the calendar. So we have some adjustments that we can do. So some adjustment is related to the month duration, so not all months are the same. So February is typically 28 days, and January is always 31 days. So this is 10% error, so there are some corrections that you can do. And the effect it can be huge. So sometimes you prefer to use a new data set, a new time series, which is the old one corrected by the number of days per month or the number of months per, the number of days per year. In R, you can use the function month-days in the forecast library in order to obtain that time series. So let me show you an example. So this is time series, which is included in the library FPP2. And you can see that month-days is telling me how many days had these days. So as you can see, for instance, 1972, 1978 has 29 days in February. Okay. So what's the difference? As you can see that if you divide by the number of months, you're correcting the data set. And this makes a lot more sense. So these little jumps here are related to the fact that we are not cutting properly every month. Of course, there are other type of calendar adjustments. For instance, the number of holidays. Holidays are more or less like Sundays, so you have to correct for that. And again, you can define a new time series, which is the old one corrected by the proportional number of holidays per month. Other types of data sets are related to money, for instance, and in that case, you have to correct for inflation. Remember that inflation is related to the idea that the value of money increases with time. And again, if you're comparing things in the past and things in the future, you have to correct for inflation because 1 euro 10 years ago is not the same as a euro today, or $1 in the 1950s is not the same as $1 today. The other type of correction that you can do is when you're playing with population. So population increases in almost all the countries in the world. So you have to correct also for population growth, especially if your data set is related to per capita information, like, I don't know, income per capita or lifespan per capita or whatever. And to finish, you know that sometimes we don't need all the data, so we have just some slices of the data in order to use validation and testing or cross-validation or whatever. So here you have some functions to do some slicing, like taking a window starting or ending at different years, subsetting by the number of indices. So here the advantages of subset versus window is that here you can have numbers like in the first three elements or the first 5 years or whatever, or you can use the traditional head and tail that we can use for any data frame.